not reflect views and opinions of our advertisers and management of Pacific Telestations LLC. This message is brought to you by the stations of KUAM.
The Buzz with Jess Lujan.
Good evening, Guam. I'm Jess Lujan. Welcome to this edition of The Buzz. Exciting show tonight. We have none other than former Senator and Judge Liz Barrett Anderson, and we're talking drug courts. No, she's not here to bail me out by any means. Welcome and good evening.
Good evening, Jess. Thank you for having me tonight.
Well, I was going to congratulate you on your retirement, but I guess it's somewhat, really, you're still kind of quasi-retired, right?
Everyone tells me that. I am quasi-retired. My husband hasn't retired yet, so why should I?
There we go.
No, I'm actually retired from the bench. I put 36 years, but I'm helping the court in projects, and there's always a need for an extra judge on the side.
There we go. And tonight, actually, we'll be talking about one of the things, one of your favorite things. You're an advocate for such a court, drug court.
Absolutely. Yeah. I'm a therapeutic judge.
There we go. Mm-hmm. Drug court. What exactly is drug court and the inception of drug court? We've been hearing lately, of course, the overcrowded prisons. We need a new prison. The feds, again, are looking at situations at DOC. And from what my reading of drug courts, it has kind of lessened the population of our island's prison.
Do you want the short version or the long version?
We've got about 22 minutes counting commercials.
Okay, I'll try to give you an abbreviated version. Drug court started about the early 90s. Mm-hmm. And there was some judge in Miami-Dade County, who, after Reagan started the war on drugs, mm-hmm. We had this revolving door of drug addicts coming in and out. And Judge Goldstein, who founded drug court, said, enough's enough. Mm-hmm. We need to get to the root of the drug usage and the drug addiction. And it's not just the crime, it's the underlining addiction. So he decided to team up with counselors and therapists and to see if that would work, and probation officers and those in the field. And he found out that by taking this kind of special attention to the drug addict and not just locking them up and throwing away the keys, mm-hmm. that you can actually be successful in rehabilitating the drug addict and keeping them out of the wheel mm-hmm. of rotation in and out of courts. Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. that's kind of putting it simply.
Now with drug court, now who qualifies? Because in reading about drug courts, it's very narrow. It's not very easy to get into drug court in the program. And one will say, hey, well, you know, it's a 2-3 week program. No, it's a pretty lengthy program, and you have to adhere to all these different things. There are different phases, again, or different stages of this drug court. Mm-hmm. How does one qualify? I'm reading this that there are two attorneys that I guess determine. But if you're not a government attorney, if you're a private attorney and you have a client that may qualify for drug court, and drug court is an alternative to sentencing, right? If not, or incarceration?
Incarceration.
Yeah.
Conviction.
Okay. Conviction. Yeah. Okay. Okay, so how does one qualify, again, to be a part or to be in the program? And I guess you have to be accepted into the program, right? You have to meet the criteria?
One of the important aspects you have to understand as an alternative conviction, anyone who has a felony conviction mm-hmm. Isn't going to get a job on Guam.
Yeah.
I mean, I've sentenced a defendants to a felony conviction. Every time I do that, I know, where are they going to get a job? Mm-hmm. So we look at drug addicts and how can we treat them mm-hmm. without literally throwing their lives
sure.
away? Drug court is anywhere from a year to a year and a half program. Mm-hmm. How do you qualify for that? Well, first of all, you have to be charged with a drug crime. Mm-hmm. And you cannot have any companion other serious or violent kind of crime, mm-hmm. such as criminal sexual conduct, burglary, use of a weapon. I mean, it has to actually be pure. You were charged with possession of crystal methamphetamine or other types mm-hmm. of Schedule II controlled
sure,
substances.
Sure.
One or two, I can't remember. Mm-hmm. And then you go through an assessment. It's not just because you're charged with a crime, you go through an assessment to see if you qualify based on a therapeutic tool
mm-hmm. sure.
That's decided. And then the prosecutor has to agree that this defendant would also qualify. Mm-hmm. And then the defense lawyer and the prosecutor along with a therapist, would say, Your Honor, this person qualifies for juvenile, I'm sorry, for drug court, adult drug court, I'm thinking juvenile drug court, and then the judge accepts or or asks more questions.
And so in that, by the time, because I mean, when I was serving the legislature, we would get this periodically, graduation for drug court. Yeah. But this is a lengthy process, and they've gone through to get to the graduation phase.
Very, very tough and lengthy.
And so that whole time, they still have to submit to, again, their probation. They got to go in.
Well, I want to make something that I did not say is, if the prosecutor recommends and agrees that the defendant should go into drug court, then the defendant would enter into what's called a deferred plea of guilty.
Okay. Okay.
Literally, it's the defendant saying before the judge, "I will plead guilty to the offense of drug charge," and the judge will say, "All right, I will not accept your guilty plea, provided you go into the program and you graduate and you're successful." Mm-hmm. And once you graduate and you're successful, your charge is dismissed and expunged.
Now, that being said, you go in the program, you mess up, okay?
Oh, you mean test positive?
You test positive, or whatever it is that you're supposed to be testing and you're supposed to be in the negative side, but you know, you've tested positive for whatever reason that you didn't adhere to what you're supposed to be adhering to. Are you automatically kicked out of the program? What happens now in lieu of that conviction? I mean, does that now, I mean,
there's
what
a hearing.
There's a hearing, okay.
There's a hearing to determine whether or not the person should be removed from drug court. And if the judge does that, then the judge has the option now to sentence the person to whatever is the maximum sentence for that crime. And I think it's usually 5 years incarceration.
You know, and I'm reading through the challenges, right, of the drug court. Of course, people to work in the drug court, finances, all that. I'm going, as one, you and I both serve the legislature, I go, with some of the challenges, mostly financial, we're going, how can drug court be successful? with the extreme challenges that it has, you know, based on, you know, we're fighting for money for everything else.
You need to bring a drug court successful graduate onto your program and to say, how were you successful? Because we do have our successes. And it's a very comprehensive, holistic approach, not only to the person's drug addiction, but to their lifestyle. It's reuniting them with their families. It's trying to get them a roof over their heads, trying to get them a job. So it's a holistic approach to this individual. And that person who's in drug court understands how lucky he or she is. This is one opportunity not to have a felony conviction on your record. Don't mess it up.
And when I'm talking about challenges, I'm reading what here it says, increase in healthcare costs resulting from medical issues arising when participants quit using, lack of reliable public transportation, you know, for those who have no vehicle and whose driver's license have been revoked, no access to public housing while felony drug charge is active, unaffordable, unreliable.
It's tough.
Yeah. And difficulty completing high school with a reading level of grade one. Clients resistant to change, funding and sustainability, limited professional resources, creators incentives. Now, I'm going, you know, people can't get to places. I'm going,
But that's not typical. Now, that's not typical.
I've attended the graduations, and I've seen it's been very successful, but with some of these challenges here that you have, you're saying, man, unless the person really wants to change, and the people that are committed to helping them change, some of these are challenges, like there's nothing you can do about mass transit.
Well, let me take it really is the power of the adult drug court judge to understand sanctions and incentives. So when a person doesn't make it down to their testing or their court hearing because there's no transportation, because there was a death in the family, and for all the reasons that you've mentioned it is that drug court judge who says, now Jesse, I know you've had some hard times, but I'm going to work with you. I want you to come back every 3 days, all right? If you can't get transportation, we'll try and get you a ticket on Guam Mass Transit. Or is there anyone else, Jesse, in your family who can help you? Anyone else in this drug court can help Jesse come down to be mm-hmm. successful. See that kind of
sure.
relationship between the drug court judge and that defendant, which is the drug court judge who has the entire team behind him mm-hmm, mm-hmm. and knows everything from the counselor to the prosecutor to the defense counsel, probation. The judge knows everything in the life of that drug court client and is there supporting the drug court client mm-hmm. because that success is a success for the program in Guam.
Now, can that client, I got to take a break here, but can that client, again, at any time, they're feeling that they're going to fall, man, I mean, life's so tough for me. You know, these are the things I got to get to this tomorrow, a lot of things in the court, you know, I haven't had been able to make my court days in these, you know, for three times. I don't have vehicle, and they're really legit, mm-hmm. you know, and they're stressing out, and it's very easy to resort to a pain reliever.
Of course.
Do they have access to, again, counselors so they can say, hey, help me out?
Absolutely. Because the one thing that we know in drug court mm-hmm. is that they are going to test positive mm-hmm. because of their stresses.
Sure.
But that's not a reason to kick them out.
Sure.
Maybe they test positive 25 times, maybe. Mm-hmm. But every case is different. But just because a drug court client tests positive, that's no reason to kick them out. It's how do you change the behavior? What has caused them mm-hmm. the stresses
sure,
that you talked
sure.
about? So let's attack the stresses. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about he has no transportation, he has no roof over his head, his family has left him. Let's talk about those stresses, because mm-hmm. if you can get to those stresses, you can help them recover and not to go to the
I mean, drugs. And you guys are putting a different face to the court, and it really is. I mean,
because... Don't I sound like an...
It really is. Yeah, it really is. I mean, you know, it's like, you know, a village to raise a child, you know, like that type thing.
I think it's Guam.
Yeah.
I really, you know, look at drug courts, and mm-hmm. it's Guam in my sense. It's the community of Guam coming around someone who needs the help mm-hmm, and not just mm-hmm. throwing them out.
Sure.
Some of them are, you know, are more difficult. It's not 100% success
sure.
rate, graduation
sure.
rate in drug court. Maybe it's an 80. Mm-hmm. If you have a high 80s, it's pretty good. But it's a dedicated judge committed to the success of every defendant that comes in there. That really means a lot.
And
shaking a hand.
And from what I hear, you know, again, the judge that is working with this individual, they take that personal. This is my baby.
They do. And we are not like the traditional mm-hmm, judges.
Sure.
We are a completely different type of breed of judges these days.
I got to pay some bills.
Okay.
Be right back.